you bring it home and you're going to.
Good evening, everybody. My name's Anthony Tamburi. I'm dean of the Chicago Decline Italian American Institute, and I'm delighted to be here in April for the third year to celebrate poetry. In fact, Bordighera Press, one of the reasons why we started publishing books as opposed to just a journal, was because of a couple of our friends who were poets couldn't, even though they were good poets, couldn't get published, so we decided that we would do something. And we had the wonderful structure behind us in Indiana Community University, which was Purdue University Printing Services, which actually was, for all practical purposes, a press in its own right, and they were great. They made some really great books back then. The books, of course, are much better today just because of the technology 30 years later. Just a couple of housekeeping things before we begin. All you poets have a program. If you don't, get a program. Those of you who are reading, get a program. Those of you who are not reading, we'll get you a program as well.
Sure.
We're going to ask.
Get your program, too. You can't tell a poet without a scorecard.
That each poet follows the other until we get to our two distinguished poets, and then they will take a minute break, that's all, and then they will come up and read as well. We're doing everything, as you can see, I think, in alphabetical order, so no one should feel slighted. Just look at your last name. If you got a question about anything, look at your last name. If you've got a double name, then we went by your second name. If you have a hyphen, we went by the first of the second name. Just to make sure that everybody understands.
What about slash?
What's going on here?
You must know this family.
Ah, I know.
Yes, you do.
This is not a unique family, let me tell you. So we'll do that. Those of you who haven't come up here yet, you can't see it, but there's a clock over here. It's going to count down 5 minutes for all of you, and it's there. And it will make a little noise at the end of 5 minutes.
And then the Sandman will come out and drive you off.
If you're in mid-stride, you finish the poem, and then that's it, okay? So, and let me just say that, you know, no one does anything, or no one oversteps boundaries intentionally. We have to be, hope springs eternal, spes ultima dea, as the ancient Romans used to say. But, you know, people get excited and they start reading, and all of a sudden, like 10, 15 minutes go by. And, you know, some of us have tried in the past, sitting, standing back there to sort of, you know, discreetly, right? Not to be into discreetly, and they're just so into their poetry, they don't notice. So we have a clock. what else? And there are books for sale. All books, regardless of whether the cover price is $12 or $26, all books are $10. So if you want to buy any books, or you want to buy a copy of Via, which is also $10, just see me or see Fred, and we'll go from there. Finally, this, in addition to being our third annual poetry festival, it's also 30 years of Bordighera Press.
All right.
Started in 1989 when we founded Bordighera Incorporated, which is a 501c3, and we started publishing immediately Voices in Italian Americana. And then, as I mentioned before, a couple of years later, we had the wherewithal to do it, and the poets needed an outlet, and so we started publishing some poets. So I want to just, before I introduce Maria Tyrone, I want to ask Fred Gardner to come up and just say a few words about Bordighera Press.
Well, what's happening here tonight is exactly why we decided to create Bordighera Press. Anthony gave you some of the background of it. The idea was to take the work that we had been doing and try to extend the community beyond the people who were in from the margin. And the people who didn't make it into from the margin, we put into the first issue of Via, Voices in Italian Americana. The people who had books that weren't getting published, that deserved to be published. I always tell people, if you can get your books published in a bigger press, please go ahead and do it. But if you can't, can't, we are a safety net for those books that must, we believe, must be published, no matter what anybody else says. And that's what we've tried to do all these 30 years. I can't tell the difference between the first year and the 30th year, actually, because it's, you know, it's just as much work now as there was back then. We do have a new managing editor for Voices in Italian Americana and Bordighera, Nick Grosso, who's taken on some of the work. But I find myself now going back and looking at the new submissions. And I'm finding many, many changes in terms of what people expect to have published nowadays. Much shorter pieces. The biggest problem I have with most of the work that comes through us is that they haven't read what a lot of these young writers haven't read the Italian American writers who came before them. So with every rejection goes the suggestion, at least when I do it, for someone that they should be reading, they should have read. And in this way, we not only create a community, but we create a community that values what came before. When we started Bordighera Press, sure, there was Italian Americana, which had been defunct at the time, which now, thanks to the work of Carlo Simonini, is back in vogue. So what we find happening with Bordighera Press is a lot of people are coming to us because they prefer to be published with us, not just, you know. And we don't, you know, those of you who have books with us, you know, we can't get a full-page ad in the New York Times. We can't get you all this publicity, and yet you still keep coming back to us. Again, I see us there as the place that can make sure that things not only get in print, but stay in print, that deserve to be in print. And I'm hoping that Bordighera Press goes on and on and on. We're looking for the new generation of people to take over. We're not quite sure when we should hand these things over or to whom we should hand these things over to, but if you are interested, please let's get to know each other so that we can sustain this ad infinitum. Thanks.
One more piece of housework. After everybody's in alphabetical order in the program, but as I said, the two distinguished featured poets will read later. So after John Gennari is not Daniela Giosetti, but rather Edvige Giunta, just so you know that you're up after John. So as Fred said, we were a bit of a safety net, but what's good is that we're no longer a safety net, as he intimated at the end, because we now have people coming to us instead of going elsewhere. And I have to say, it was the last couple of years we've gotten submissions that said, I have an offer to publish with blank, but I'd really like to publish with Bordighera Press. And so, you know, that satisfaction is just sort of indescribable. But it's not just us. It's because of the works that we publish that obviously have, you know, inspired people to come to us. And so so it's just great. It's just great all around. And the other thing is that we've also become a place to go to now for critical essays, books on Italian-American culture, Italian-American literature, and Italian-American cinema or Italian cinema. So it's been really rewarding in that sense. Nick is our editor now, the new editor for Via, for Voices in Italian Americana. Those of you who have worked with Nick know that he is not an easy editor.
He's excellent.
He has a really strict pen.
Yes, he does.
But he's excellent. He is. He's got a great eye, and so we're really fortunate there. But as Fred said, you know, the three of us, Fred, Paolo Giordano, and I are, as we say, of a certain age. And, you know, if we're around in 30 years, it'll be a miracle, a biological miracle. So we do need those under 50, if not under 45, to come forward and sort of help out. So without further ado, Maria, I'm going to give it to you, and then we'll start after Maria. I'm going to be sitting over there with the telecomando. setting and resetting the clock.
Buona le, buon ascolto, and to the poets, buona lettura.
Hi, everyone. I'm going to read first some remarks that Carla Simonetti, the editor of Italian Americana, had just emailed to me today because she can't be here. I would like to first thank Maria Tirone and Anthony Tambori for once again organizing this event, and to apologize for not being able to attend due to another commitment, which incidentally is also related to promoting an Italian-American writer at the Italian Cultural Institute in Chicago. I attended the previous two poetry readings and enjoyed them very much. At Italian Americana, we have the privilege of printing some exquisite poems, but as beautiful as they are when read silently to oneself, nothing compares to the experience of hearing them read aloud by the poets themselves. I will miss hearing your voices. I want to underscore also how important I believe this collaboration between VIA and Italian Americana to be. We are two journals that serve the same greater purpose of promoting Italian American culture, and nothing is more relevant to that end than proving a creative platform for our artists to share their work, and I could not agree more with those sentiments. I wish you all a wonderful evening and look forward to attending the fourth annual VIA Italian Americana poetry reading next April. So just a few words from me. I'm, of course, very, very happy that we're here together, that you've come, that we have this tradition begun 3 years ago, that we're continuing. Thank you for being part of this. I thank Anthony Tambori for being such a warm and gracious host, and as one of the co-founders of Bordighera Press, for publishing many of us. Being the poetry editor at Italian Americana is very gratifying to me in many ways. Publishing established poets is an honor, to put it in one word. It's a great feeling to have their work in our pages. But it's also wonderful to discover talent that I wasn't aware of. And this event gives me the opportunity to invite some poets from outside the New York area to connect with the Italian-American community of writers that I think we're really fortunate to have in New York City. And people who know me know that I like to bring people together in general, so it's especially satisfying for me to play this role when I can. A few of the poets reading tonight came from a very long distance, and I'm actually meeting them for the first time tonight. So that said, let's dive into the poetry. And the first reader up is Peter Carabetta.
The clock starts when I start reading.
The clock starts when you start reading. I let you go in 5 minutes.
These are my two books that are outside. Epigraph. We now have some to adapt at which the restatement of the obvious is the first duty of intelligent men, George Orwell. There is certainly a creeping cacophony of indictments and complaints entirely available on the waves, the wires, the ubiquitous monitors about the wreckage of the past two decades. But think, Alan, about the fact that so many, count them by the hundreds, in well-ensconced network covers and boardrooms at both the major international dailies and supposedly alternative websites have been prognosticating that something really, really huge is afoot. Something the likes of which human history has not seen its equal. It is variously violent, vigilant, vitriolic, venturesome, virulent, viriac. It is the product of the countless allegorical monsters of our cosmic fears turned upon themselves with the rage of Cerberus, with suicidal madness. Logotechnical trauma, his name. But people around here refer to him simply as Lopez. Magmatic of virtual obsessions and reduplicating bionic flows run among the few surviving thinking hominids of Millennium 3, or M3 for short. Lotek is the theory of relativity come to life and in power. 2, Lotek knows the truth is merely a tall tale, to wear, to work, to refashion, as the need to stage pomp and circumstance demand. All recent history attests to that. Lotek knows that even among competing factions, some of the mega companies that know no birthright, nor clan, nor affection, nor collective memory, because they are international, and they are liquid, phosphorescent, plasma, and whose leaders are psychotically bent on accumulation, exploitation, extortions, while legally concealing offshore accounts, trust funds, and Nigeria. Yes, even among such an infernal accolade of cutthroats like the devils of Malebolge, Lotek agrees that it is okay to step on people, foment conflict, sell any crap for a buck. More power, more influence, more control, more godliness, more airspace, more airtime, more of the empty same, more of unprecedented shame. Part 3. In the unlimited stratosphere of arrogance, the sleazy mongrels speak hardly a coherent sentence, babbling and stumbling like recovering dope addicts, and yet, clever marionettes that they are, the verbs stapled recto and verso for legitimacy, the nouns contrived to appeal to rich and poor alike. A list of DC speak is forthcoming. It's a reductio ad absurdum of the logos of the warp age. The teleimages bamboozle the indifferent and the world-logged, and for those just tuned in, echoes and fantasies are banded as the whisper of him above. Nay, God's own very voice. Naturally, it is the true God. Other people's just a surrogate. To whom the privileged, starstruck, bumbling Bible thumbers think they converse with the literalness of a child, an idiot. Ah, but Alan, did you really believe Main Street that changed so much, changed its tune since you've gone? Are you blind or something now that presumably you can see us mortals for what we really are? The lies told the people are not perceived as such. That they are lies doesn't no longer matter. Far too many citizens have been thinking themselves beyond reproach in being on the right side of the equation, in upholding universal values and all that vomit, while pundits and moguls and angers, and lo, the pros too now, see to it that 80% of the population is, well, suckered up into advertising fantasies or unexamined childish expectorations. This is well known, Alan, but the tragedy is that no one seems to be able to stop it. The terror is inside. Alan, and the Lotek knows that.
Thank you, Anthony. Thank you, Maria, for hosting this beautiful evening. I had planned to read two short poems, one from Via, one from Italian Americana. And then yesterday I read in the news that after 128 years, the current mayor of New Orleans is planning to issue an apology to Italian Americans for the lynching that took place in New Orleans in, well, 128 years ago. So I decided to switch gears and read this poem, which I think is apropos of the occasion. Also, this poem was written, I guess, about a year ago when I read Anthony Tamburi's article in La Voce in New York, When We Were the Muslims, I think it was titled, an excellent article, which also spurred something in me. It could have, you know, we could be Mexicans, we could be Muslims, we could be anything today. It's how easily we forget. And I think that what gets me the most is those of us, Italian Americans, who don't take the time to learn our own history. So many, I think, people, especially the ones wearing those red hats that say, make America great again, don't bother, or maybe conveniently forget to know their history. Anyway, I want to get to the poem that I borrowed a little bit of the title from Anthony, called When We Were the Other. And I couldn't help myself but put a caption there. It said, this is the voice of your forefather, my forefather. He was a young man then. We carried pots and pans on our backs like circus tents. Our hunger could be seen in the other's jawbones. We boarded boats that broke paths in the vast ocean. I was excited to watch the ocean foam. Then one day land appeared. On deck, we clapped and smiled, shared what remained unspoken, and some of us made it to a sun-kissed bayou. We smelled salty marsh air in the morning, caught jumping catfish with our bare hands. The girls ground sassafras with mortar and pestle. The girls smelled like orange peel back home. One beauty lay lulling in the sun. It all happened at once, that first deep joy between us. She drew her mouth toward mine. I knew her pulse. Under a cypress, we were brokenness made unbroken. Unbroken, my girl said, when she kissed my fingertips. Then we went back to looking the way we did, back to our shanties in a row. We'd named Little Palermo as a way of belonging. My mother bending over a coal stove, my mother smelling of spice bush and blue-eyed grass. She farged and dried to make teas. That woman could heal any sickness except hate. When we were front page news in the Daily States, like the Negro, only filthier in habit, a villainous looking set terrorizing the nation. We were fruit peddlers, street sweepers, loading dock hands. We were juice for the Confederate president's speeches, fuel for angry citizens preparing for action. We were Southern Italian, too dark to be honest. Accused of killing Hennessy, chief of police. We were hundreds loaded into mule-drawn carriages. My girl shouted, reggiti, reggiti, hold on, hold on. I held on to one strong shoulder. He asked me, Maone Yamo, where are we going? We went down past Tulane. We held on. Whittled down to 19, then 11. We were Rocco, Pietro, Antonio, Emanuele, Tony, Loretto, Bastian, Joseph, James, Frank, Charles, tried in court and acquitted. Returned to parish prison on other charges. And the bloodthirsty stormed in, and the warden turned a blind eye, and they all jeered and harangued, "Who killed the chief?" One of us whimpered, "Not guilty." One of us proudly replied, "I was born in Louisiana." One of us stammered and cried, "I live here 60 years. We were 9 Dagos, plucked and shot. Lay weltering in blood and brains. We were 2 hanged on the lamppost off Trem Street. We were 1 riddled with 42 bullets after the dangling. We were others whose names disappeared from the record. One fled to Vicksburg and one to Tallulah. One clung to life when a tree branch snapped. And if it's true that our true selves emerge closest to death, then my father took in the cottonwood's tiny red blooms, caught a glimpse of the mighty Mississippi, had his memory of his woman in the sun, while the crowd found a sturdier branch, and the determined hurled him up a final time, and a dozen bullets put an end to his writhing as his grieving young son ripped out his own eyes. March 14, 1891, New Orleans. Thank you.
Also a runner, so I'm rushing into language. Okay, I choose the shorter ones. Okay, subway semantics. The lick of beer, the lake it feeds, the feet close by, the face beside. In rush hours, arms and legs flood with elegies, stairways and trains, having no ideas of all the pages they're leaving behind in the bustly cloud. The lingo's on air, the careless looks, the horny hand, the broken film. Subway semantics, overturns aesthetics, sounding like music, but chanting no ethics. Spring now. Wearing pink air as a balaclava, and first concocting, then humming, a crispy war cry. It is sabotaging winter, heading to outshine. Criminal and terrorist, the only legitimate green card holder, has entered the country, smuggling in a cargo of color and wonder. The remedy. To make Coney Island drop its sad smile, I would set up a bonfire, collect paper petals, paint them with poetry, Dante, Neruda, Dylan, of course, sprinkle them down the skimpy fabric of its clown pants and have dimples button its cheeks. To make your tears swim back to sea and have your chest be washed again with rays of light, days of delight. I would bring your body, your pangs and distress, afore the restored cheer of Coney Island's shore. Agape. You swallow bridges, litter and skyscrapers. You soak in sorrows of sorrowful immigrants and munch complaints from mourning millennials. Sometimes you think you've had enough. Now you leave the place and look for peace on remote shores to detox your being. No more scrub gobbling, enough with intaking. The mayhem far off you get to see. That food is no junk, that flesh is no skunk. Only the deepest pitch churns out the purest light. Time as a novel. The instant an egg crashes its head and the merciless on the merciless edge of your frying pan, and there your breakfast is smiling back. Or the gore second before a bubble walks into its death, wearing pink and teal, are paragraphs you can steal from the Times novel to describe what love makes you feel. Amnesia. My body is swimming, belly blinking at the seafloor, back flirting with the sky above. In a matter of seconds, a peak-shaped shade groped the girly light. Just a cloud passing by, I thought jovially, or some prehistoric bird making fun of the sun. Back on the beach, my moves stopped, my mouth dropped, the feeling of skin getting snagged amid itch and stretch. No matter the amnesia you can buy for cheap, you'll never get away from the day you leave. Love trip in New York City, falling. Once I've learned the language of your steps and grasped the chant of your eyes, I took a match, brought it closer to erudition, and made comparisons. Keep falling. From your eyelids, from your mouth, from your navel too, I patiently wait for the light your body holds captive. And sometimes you fail to control, and sometimes trickles into the world.
It's Garcia, and thank you so much for having me. I have three short poems. Each one's dedicated to a different person. Can everyone hear me all right? Okay. The first one is for Dr. Leslie Goldstone Orley. She's my gynecologist. It's called, Have You Ever Been a Victim of Violence? 11 Reasons Why I Don't Check Yes. One, because the box, once X'd, can't be undone. Two, because to check the box is like a sadder version of, I voted. Three, because I'll disappoint my angel of a gynecologist. She'll ask me when, and see I've kept the truth from her for years. Four, because, damn it, I resent the box just waiting there to ambush me again. Five, because I bristle at the label victim and survivor. Can't win, both dice are loaded. Six, because the waiting room is Starbucks busy. Seven, because the box is no confessional. Eight, because there is no exorcist on staff. Nine, because don't ask me to concede a thing when it's already such a feet in stirrups, flashlight on my cervix kind of day. Ten, because of women wearing crowns of thorns far thornier than mine. 11, because what grit I've got, I rationed. The second poem is called All Things Lost. It's for my Uncle T. God answered her novenas with a baby, yet my handsome father was so ugly, the forceps unforgiving in delivery, she wouldn't waste the good name that she had chosen. She had come of age in the Depression, thus saved the good name for the second son. My father's would-be name she gave to you and shared that fact. Not cruel, only true. A matriarch does what she has to do. Like when you found a cat, a coal black stray, she let you keep him. Inky ran away, or so her story went, until one day I asked if you and Dad had owned a pet. She liked to keep the house immaculate, and coming clean at last, she would admit, hard to raise you boys alone, she'd taken Inky for a ride across town. A trifle, next to losses yet unknown, your friends in Vietnam, black granite names, your hearing, marred, artillery close range, your full-grown son, your only child, estranged. Yet, cradling you, uncle, to her chest, she named you for the saint she loved most, Anthony, the saint of all things lost. And I'll end on a more upbeat note. This poem is called I Never Fell in Love with You, and it's for my husband. And he couldn't be here tonight. To fall in love implies a lack of choice. As if I were cartoonish, maladroit, and love an open manhole to avoid. To fall suggests a kind of loftiness, that I began in some exalted place and not the airy of my loneliness. To fall, like rain or tears or mercury, a pawn of Cupid or of gravity. No, with my grappling hook, I climbed precisely. To fall, kerplunk, is stumbling, imperfection. No, I would brave the hot tar of rejection to wear the ermine cloak of your affection. I built a trebuchet and aimed to sail beyond your moat, over your castle wall. I launched, I soared in love. I did not fall. Thank you.
Blessings. Last time I saw a nun in a habit, she was being pummeled by my mother. Nixon era, 4th of July parade in Pittsfield. Jimmy, Joni, Mom, and me, Pop working holiday shift for time and a half. This was back when Life and Look and the television networks covered the Pittsfield parade. So perfectly did it mythify America. North Street teeming with families, crowds running five or six bodies deep on both sides. We jostle for better position, but the nun's habit blocks our view. Writing her own chapter in the history of Italian anti-clericalism, Mom hauls off and shoves the nun out of the way. Sorry, sister, she says, feigning a sign of the cross. Just because you're a nun doesn't make you special. Soaps. Now it's Zio Tullio, but as kids we called him Uncle Trip. The nickname came from his exploits on the baseball diamond, where his devil-may-care fire and fleetness of foot resulted in a ton of triples. The St. Louis Cardinals offered him a contract, but he had to stay home to take care of his orphaned younger siblings. Instead, he toiled for many years as a tool and die man at General Electric. In the early years of television, in the 50s, he'd walk home for lunch, eat his salami sandwich watching his favorite soap opera, then go to the back porch and gab across the clothesline with neighborhood Italian women. In later years, after Little Italy broke up and there were no women to gab with, he'd spend an afternoon every week driving around to the utility companies
to pay up that week's bill and to talk as the world turns in Days of Our Lives with the office girls. Notes from a Hungry Life. One, every article of clothing I own, save a random few underwear, socks, and hats, is food stained. Two, in restaurants, it's all I can do to keep myself from filching food off other people's plates. In a coffee shop, I start eating a blueberry muffin belonging to the unknown woman sitting adjacent to me. Three, in my local supermarket, I'm chastised by a supervisor for taking a piece of sample bread from the bakery, walking it over to the hot buffet table, and drenching it in the runoff juices in a tray of broiled chicken. Four, I lie awake at night, alternatively anguishing and exulting over leftover broccoli. Will it make its way into a redemptive dish of rigatoni with olive oil, chili peppers, and chickpeas? Or will it languish for too long, decompose, and break my heart? Gig. The Gig isn't a part of Brooklyn not yet on the hipster map. You walk out of the subway into a gritty streetscape of gas stations and abandoned industrial buildings. The pedestrian traffic is limited to a few hangdog musicians shouldering their instrument cases like crosses. At the appointed address, you push a buzzer to get in, conspiratorially, by a woman who turns out to be the piano player you've been reading about in the experimental music blogs. Your friend Tanya, the violist, recently back from a mission to introduce improvisation to Afghanistan, sets you up with a heaping plastic cup of bad red wine. You focus your attention on the drummer, a devotee of the epileptic school of rhythmic accompaniment. No time or pulse, no effort to hold the meter or bolster the sonic bottom, just spasms of acoustical texture over the top of the band's vibrating drone. Let this one serve as an introduction to the next poet. Cooking with Eddie. We start with our top of the morning ritual. Tall glasses of water with freshly squeezed lemon. So cleansing, croons Eddie with her starched consonants and caressed vowels. Eddie likes how I squeeze the lemon, catching the seeds in my fist. You squeeze the lemon, she commands. Spouses and children sleep. We lean on the counter, silently calculating work rate, tempo, sequence. No plan, no checklist, just a tacit understanding, the weight and the magic of the day, ours. Poets are coming, scholars, essayists, writers of every ilk, troubadours, drummers, sexy women of a certain age, refugees, do-gooders, frauds, recent graduates with firm convictions, townspeople with unhealthy addictions, couples with issues, dashing men in silk scarves. What will it take in edibles and potables to keep everyone comfortably awed? Two types of polenta, plain for soaking up sauce and stray runoff juices, savory garnished with sopressata and asiago, platters of chicken thighs and breasts baptized in succulent overnight marinade, salads of righteous greens, erotic tropical fruit, crunchy seeds and nuts, a moiling orgy of pastas. Is this enough puttanesca? Let's double it, just to be safe.
Boys will smell your period. Thus, my older sister justified my banishment from the passeggiata. Or perhaps it was my cousin, the same with whom I watched the prostitutes from the third floor balcony in the ancient building inhabited by ghosts that hid in secret wells and cells. There was a girl who lived above us. Our balconies were so close that if we stretched our arms, our hands could touch. Her mother was a prostitute, and I knew I could never ask to play with her. But every day, I reached up, and our fingers met. Dolls. Of little Carmelina, no photos exist. Yet, my grandmother painted such a detailed picture of her firstborn daughter that I remember her in a stroller-like seat. A year or so, her tiny arms and legs, limp, head, lolling, sadness on that round face, big eyes full of foreknowledge. There was no name for the disease that killed her at 17 months. Nonna said her bones didn't grow. As a child, I held the broken dolls tenderly. One, named Daniela, could not keep her head screwed into her neck. My heart ached for her. I already knew how to love the wounded. Bye. In the beginning, there is the apartment on the ground floor of Largo Cadore numero 9 and caffè latte with lots of sugar, and Robertino lives across from us and has a sister older than mine with long, straight hair. One day we play nurse and doctor. He's lying face down on the first step outside grandma's door. I pull down his shorts, drawn to sweet pink flesh, and bite, 4-year-old teeth marks. In the commotion of cries and the dolls hovering, I find a hiding place squeezed in the narrow space between the fridge and the wall. The mountain. The mountain wasn't even a hill. It was the slightly raised undeveloped area near the Palazzine Popolari where my grandparents lived. It was the destination of excursions in search of treasures. We gathered smooth stones, the silvery paper lining cigarette packs, cigarette butts, long wheels of toy cars, the mysterious parts broken off unknown objects. We collected it all in our pockets, which mothers and grandmothers would search and empty later. The detritus that accumulated on the flanks of the mountain waited for us every day to be rescued and loved. And this is the last one. Non-present tense. There is no present tense in my mother's grammar of joy. Carpe diem illuser. She only knows past and future. The present comes riddled with misery, disappointment, and the promise of certain loss. For once I go along, I say, didn't we have a good time yesterday? Or, Clyde and I could come together next year. I sprinkle our conversations with memories and hopes, avoiding the present moment as if we were crossing a minefield, even as I secretly step into it when I hold arthritic hands or kiss her cheeks, smooth, cool, rosy, untouched by time. Thank you.
My name is John Hennessy. No relation. We just make that stuff you'd like to drink. We have to run away. Thank you, Maria, for inviting me. Open season, 2016. This afternoon they're shooting in the woods. I can hear blasts from my kitchen. Veterans Day. Too late for game. Asserting, celebrating office. They're too close. It's unnerving. To the window, the side door, see if I can see. Too many trees. Some backyard rodent keeps chewing the pumpkin. Weird prayer. Brilliant offering for my grandfather, DAV, on our deck. There won't be an hour's much longer. But for now, I'm left with my grandfather, who got dispensation from his dying father to fight against Sicily. He saw war coming in the 30s. Grandpa only made it as far as New Guinea. Grenade, back injury. In and out of VA hospitals the rest of the century. Tough old SOB. Took him years to be made supervisor at the PO because he wouldn't join the party. Ilya, from Serbia, formerly my uncle, explained when I asked why Grandpa Cusumano, three jobs, Elizabeth triple deckers, tiny prefab house around the corner from Merck, 10 kids, on official forms, check not white, but other, was a Republican. Grandpa's not a Republican, John. He's a fascist. Ah, simplicity. He believed in obedience, loyalty, family, solution to everything. Beat his sons, bent their necks to kiss their mother's feet. Beat his daughters, too. That last black eye got him to Carrier Clinic. Next generation, he only washed my mouth out with soap. Can't remember the signal word. He was devoted to me. There's not a day I don't love and miss him. Must have been some invocation. I know, I want. Wish I could say it now. Instead, I Hail Mary. Bonnie and mine begging me for silent exercise. Head into the woods hoping the dogs run. Gunshots quiet down. Let me scatter leaves alone. This is for my son, Nick. Who will save now you're grown? Falls bank drop, jukebox colors piling up. Once down, James Brown shuffle and split. Wind wears the mounds away, moonwalking through, slap happy spinning, brief red, then yellow flares. Leaves, good as money, dollar dollar bill. Younger, you trade me red for Indian pipe, corpse plant. Orange, bought fallen nests, quick skill, craft, calculation. Yellow, tapped apples, knife carved wedges, Christ eye centers, pippin stars. The slide into piles, tick-check, grass stain, one time per annum, fixed rate, rake. Long boulevards of trunks and stumps seemed stopgaps, the sublime uselessness carting the drop would prove. Whose will broke bank those afternoons? Agreed, we stood still. I'll end with this damage for Rue. What elegant shapes your mother staked you to. Lemniscate waist, Ouroboran key. Such long, thin wrists, delicate ankles, twee praxitelean feet. A mind no snake could ever swallow. Your father made her suffer the peak of familiar hurt and jealousy. His charm, the shifting fulcrum between you three. You swore you'd write, eclipse his brightest lover. And now you have. You're lucid, even in your fury, strangely gentle, patient with me, while I'm as clabber sour, nominam sweet, as any of your characters. I nod protean, fishhook, blue eye, beloved palimpsest, dark radiance, multivalent, someone's left.
thank you to Maria and to Anthony for having me here. I'm honored. And I'm going to read a handful of short poems about travel and especially about the ongoing tension I always feel between desperately wanting to wander and missing the people I love back home. So this one is called After Travel. I bolt upright into the dark, in a room I don't recognize, a city I can't name. Feel along the walls for my last known whereabouts, Roman catacombs, a hive of tunnels where mourners buried their dead, markers worn featureless by time. And before that, sun-bleached Mezzogiorno, stone upon stone, a city stifled by ash. Experts poured plaster into negative space to recapture what crumbles to dust. Bodies frozen in flight, backs arched in horror or curled inward, reflexively groping for the beloved, the familiar. I feel the bones of this strange bed, and the past trickles back, cools into shape. This room I once called mine, the sheets that wrapped the self I left behind. And this one is called Ex Voto. Along this corridor, candles in rows broadcast heat, each flicker held apart and harmless by glass, garnet, amethyst, or appetite. When bodies pass, flames genuflect and lick the air, a clamor of tongues. On rough brown stone, more wishes hang, tin offerings, a leg, an eye, a breast. Snapshots, a cottage, a motorbike, one child-sized crutch, each an emblem of desire, made physical, released into the world. This chamber, balanced on a cliff, expands to hold all it must, or maybe someone comes at dusk to bear these offerings away, and snuff out each small fever, letting night wash in an anodyne, soothing, neutral, and blue. Scrapbook. Among postcards, ticket stubs, URL passes, the small square photos I chose and mounted have yellowed into antiques, though the girl who lives in each square is still me, hair shorn, arms sinewy from lugging a rucksack, legs muscled from climbing bell towers and Alps. Here she perches on the cool marble lip of a fountain at Versailles, guzzling Pinot Gris on $10 a day. Here she sprawls on train station steps beside the Grand Canal, till dawn when a policeman's boot will nudge her awake. She juggles phrase books, confuses Italian, Spanish, and French, tumbles daily into something she calls love, each Sicilian or Californian an experiment in drowning out old pain with new. Every train, a magician's scarf that whisks her off stage, each fresh cityscape washing away the last. What she wants is what I hold, the unsettled, unsettling future, neutralized, alchemized, frozen in gold. And this will be the last one. It's called Neat. At cruising altitude, the earth comes clean. The makeshift garbage heap of man-made things and nature's thousand tangled hues of green made tidy by the miles. Seen past our wings, roads run straight and silos glint like dimes, each swimming pool slick as a polished gem. Even mountain ranges, wild sublimes of river, butte, and canyon, figure trim and tailor cut, their splendid disarray, mere patterns on a rug. Obedient and orderly, the planet curls away, its edges gently smudged, but on descent, it tugs us back, its noise an ample mess, as welcome as a lover's sloppy kiss.
My name is Maria Lucella, and first I would like to thank this community because it indeed is a community. My husband, Gil Fagiani, died last year, April 12th, and I was unable to participate in this great gathering, but I know many of you read his poems, and you've all been really wonderful this year, so thank you so much. To that end, I'm going to channel Gil and read one of his poems first, which is in this gorgeous book, which is a Boy the Ghetto book, which was launched in October. Ogni santo vuol la sua candela. Every saint wants their own candle. Mount Sinai, East 102nd Street. Like clockwork, every day at rush hour, he shuffles into the middle of the intersection in his floppy corduroy slippers, robe open, gray curls twisting out of a torn Santa cap. When the light turns green, he takes a bow onto oncoming traffic, curtsies at irate drivers who flip him the bird, blows kisses at the crossing guards who yell at him to keep moving. One of them laughs. He's my friend, but he's crazy. After a cacophony of curses, car horns, ambulance, yelps, he gives another bow, face aglow, chortling to himself, shambling to the other side of Madison Avenue. I think he wrote that while he was still getting chemo and we had a lot of hope. So this is a piece I've written this year. Still yours. You have to get rid of his clothes, my friend advises. She lost two sisters too young to die. She wants me to get over you, over it, move on to where she wants me to be. I don't just visit your clothes, I wear them. And what does not fit, I alter. A second skin, a way to walk tucked inside your memory. I hook my fingers into the belt loops or slip them into the front pocket of your jeans. I wear almost every day. I stand just so, mirror the you I know so well. Others notice I favor one hip, as you did. I run my fingers over the collared shirts, the nubby linens, silk ties splashed with colors like so many banners from all parts of the world. I picture my revolutionary, who so loved his Brooks Brothers shirts that reminded him of his early shopping sprees with his dad, who was so intent on molding him into his own image, capitalist, Republican. Silliest of all, I crumble at the sight of the sock drawer. Hundreds of white ones, long ones, short ones, these among the last items you touched and folded. Just as you did my lingerie, yet you left no scent behind. So many things I could not fix. I wanted to make life better for you. Gave instead myself, whoever I may have been, at that moment in time, imperfectly yours. This piece is for our first anniversary, or his first anniversary. They ask how I will observe your passing 1 year later. A friend arranged a mass dedicated to you, a spiritual celebration or reckoning, depending on your faith. I might choose to ignore that dreadful day when I sat close to your ear, encouraging you to go. Take leave of all you loved. That day, your final breath departed. Not with a gasp, but expelled with power. That day changed everything. No way to harness the events to come. I could not hold you back. Selfishly, I would have kept you, broken, crippled, would have dedicated myself to you, but you chose to make this your time to go. A choice I could only honor. You followed the arc of what we were born for, shattering our beautiful plans for the future. Your staggering belief still mystifies me that you are sure you will see me over and over again, guiding me that day to the next rungs of love, life, and the first spring without you. Thank you. Thank you.
name is Stephen Massimilla, and the first poem I'd like to read appeared in Italian Americana, thanks to Maria. It's entitled Above the Insomniac Sea. Scimitar Beach cuts the bay in starlight, black surface searched by a beam that speeds the crests and jumps what it cannot touch. To skip, to glance above the book, to wake, to be touched by you know not what. Hard waves as of wounded otters thump below the door, frightening the surf noise back out to sea. Under bulbs behind drawn curtains, ghost of gauze in a frame breathes in above, a clutch of sheets, the narrow bed, on the pillow, the woman in white. Now touch this paper cover as you would touch the beach light. Open it like a wing untouched by the lamp that enlarged it, each word a moth that beats on a screen. Bruise spreads through the shark's head sound, rippling to hint at back fin or head bone, a hadrosaur, each crease touched by the nether, reef, a landscape never to emerge, a language, a surface touched by whatever was, an underlife long over, shadowed by amnesia, the sleeper leaning late and reading there. Shark's head sound, by the way, is a body of water, not the sound that a fish makes. The next poem I'd like to read help bridge the gap between Italian Americana and the Via, and to help bridge that gaping chasm, I'd like to read a poem that appeared in Via, thanks to Peter. And since I'm holding this up, I might as well mention that it actually appeared later in this book, Cooking with the Muse, which contains not only hundreds of poems, many of them I own, but also hundreds of recipes and a lot of prose about culinary and literary matters and nutritional information and historical notes and hundreds of photographs and so forth. So reading this book and in writing this book, we can learn a lot about the cultural, moral, philosophical, political, and socio-historical significance of tomatoes and carrots and artichokes and potatoes and so forth. To give an example, and maybe you need to give me 30 seconds off the clock for this, but the tomato, I mean, how did the sun-dried tomatoes make it here to Calandra in the focaccia over there? I mean, think about the historical journey it had to take from way down where they were first cultivated in South America to 1,000 miles north, to the north in Mexico, and then they had to travel from Montezuma's banquet table to the old world on the ships of Columbus, and then where they were summarily rejected in Europe for hundreds of years. No one would eat them. They were just placed on mantelpieces to absorb all the evil in the room. And that's because the French dubbed them, dubbed the what we now call the tomato, le pomme d'or, from which we get Italian pomodoro, as you know. But a lot of Europeans thought they were saying le pomme d'amour, which would make it the forbidden love apple of the devil, and you can't eat that. But it was the Tuscans, it was Cosimo de' Medici who first took a liking to it, and really no one else in Italy except the Tuscans, the people in what is now southern Italy and central Italy would eat it. So we celebrate that with a recipe for the Tuscan roasted tomato soup with a Parmesan Gruyere Frico here. And I want to read the tomato poem that goes with this, but I can't because it didn't appear in Via, and Maria Lasella has already heard it. But another point I wanted to make is that how did it get there? Well, it had to be brought here by Italian immigrants 100 years ago. And so we owe the popularity of the tomato to the popularity of Italian food. And the same can be said of the artichoke, for instance, which is originally an immigrant from the Middle East, but it was brought here by Italian immigrants 100 years ago. And so in an age of border of walls, or talk of border wall emergencies, to keep out the tired and the hungry and the poor, and talk of travel bans, which we do have in place now, I'm thinking so many of the trumped up divisions in this country could be overcome if people only better understood the history of fruits and vegetables. So I'm going to read, really, food brings people together. I'm going to bring this fast as we saw in John's poems. And also, I was thinking of April's poems, the focus on traveling. The poem I'd like to read is called Metafora from the Italian. It's got an Italian title. And the term in Latin means to travel from place to place. So ultimately, there's this paradox. We cannot distinguish what is local from that which travels. Metafora. The word means to carry from place to place. Not that I can estimate the distance. Love is love of nothing but from to the base of the mountain where oil and cheeses cool in caves shaded by cypresses. South Italian cuisine is not all that metaphoric. You savor the locality of the ingredients, the secret, the way the sun flashes from your cuticle into a pure shell of hemisphere, the way the sea that leans behind your thumb is what the centuries come after, come over in ships of innumerable sizes, rarely more than one, a few at a time. The whiff of two flame-lit sardines or a battered Parmesan is enough to drown out the fleets of Aeneas and Odysseus. Between this sail in the Bay of Naples and that one, a speck of volcanic ash in mist, Vesuvius is speechless. That mountain of shadowy facets lost its horsetail plume mere decades ago. In the crater, one burnt-out eye, live stone boiling beneath. According to Ovid, the Cyclops Polyphemus pre-appeared south of this region, with his vision intact, focused on a nymph who sent him packing under clouds which cling to old Sicilian peaks, like sheepish lovers of a tale in which lovers full of tales recall the way the blind bard originally retold it. The clouds of Etna shift like sheep grazing on crusts of shade before the evening meal, morsels over which to ruminate on how to navigate time and space. Shades escape the sun's eye by clinging to fleecy bellies. These vapory signals foreshadow the risk of taking for the tangible feast and burnt offering the cattle of the sun that, because they are immortal, live on not as if nothing more, but as if nothing more than metaphor. Thank you.
Now I know why when my sister says I come over, all the tomatoes dry up. Maria, thank you for inviting me and believing in my work. This first poem was just recently in that time of that time. It's called OCD. The recurrences of the universe rose to the maddening rhythm of the incantation, and I began to see an idea. G.K. Chesterton. The whirring flywheel and its casing sings. Outside, beyond the ordered stars and suns, planets with their moons change the belts and pulleys soon. Grease the bearings and springs. God, with an ear to the equator, feels for a wobble, tick, drag, catch in the throat, scratch in the lining. His upside down bite with two long wrenches centering the wheels, obsessing over the outermost slings. Delinquent asteroid, misfire, stutter, kink, flat note, missed syllable, lisp, slightest chink, cymbal crash, the sudden end of all things. Petals and daisy chains. Aurora's bands, snowflakes, syncopation, drifted dunes, each perfect phase of the moon. Alternately checking the knob and washing his hands, sorting the universe atom by atom, whispering to himself, molecule, moon, wing, fin, star, how far will he go to be sure through the purple cosmos atom that we delight on? Delicate mobile of invisible strings, crankshaft and piston, plankton, wings, stamen, and pistil, buckshot, black hole, diamond zygote, inkwell, and crowquill. Seahorse, driftwood, steamship whistle, the timepiece order of the heavens, all its tendons, throttles, levers, whirling angels and rings, rust, chlorophyll, thistle. Counting to himself, second guessing each death, systole, diastole, jellyfish, umbrellas snapped open against the sudden rain, huddled strangers, lovers close, closer, their breath. And this poem is called Breathe. For my youngest of my three kids, Leonardo, who had a most difficult time getting here. Breathe to Leonardo. Your struggle for a first breath seemed the way one might struggle for the last. Eyes wide, blue face swollen with fear, falling from the familiar into the strange. I remember my father flailing, fighting the ambulance attendants, his last act of defiance yanking off the oxygen mask. And me bossing the nurses and doctor as they passed you sharply like a baton. A nurse massaging your feet, the small cut from her nail blossoming on the back of your heel as they worked to stop you from sliding straight through the other side. As if once pinched into this world, it leaned hard to dump you back, a man clinging to a speeding car. The cord was constricting around your neck while time played all its best slow motion tricks. Those long minutes I smiled one face to your mother and glared at demons at the others. An outlaw holding the doctor at gunpoint as he removed a slug from her belly, his nurse nervously cooling her brow. And all the while they beat that snake with a hoe, I pleaded to you through oceans and space. My little diver who would not surface, too stubborn to release your treasure. My tiny astronaut tangled in your tether, late from your spacewalk of gentle repairs, fat glove pearls, diamonds, and stars. My folklore sailor, discovered after 20 years of mysterious tapping, lying in a dry chamber with a hammer next to the hull. Squeezing into this world, hinges singing like angels, at times like demons, gates banging in the wind as you ran into my arms. From first and last knoll, how different the view. The world when we are climbing higher, the world when we are spiraling down. The wave water tastes when we are thirsty, the wave water tastes while we drown.
Okay, so I'm going to begin with a poem from Via from a few years ago. It's called To Begin Again. Open the new calendar, a grid of days, white boxes like regiments, all in order and accounted for, alert before the Sahara of the new year. Time's persistent sirocco that sculpts the meticulous empty landscape. Open the new year to 365 town squares and close your eyes to picture the daily passeggiata. How surreal it would be to strut across the cobblestones alone. In separate squares, people begin to appear, smoking by a fountain, sipping espresso, glancing at a watch that frowns back 8:20 a.m. or p.m., who knows? One by one, they fill the spaces, friends, colleagues, cousins, and slouching at the margins mid-year, those strangers waiting for you to show. Next two poems had appeared in the Hudson Review. Well, this one, I was walking in Manhattan, it was winter, it was early evening, and I was literally stopped in my tracks by a vision, and I actually started writing the poem right there on the sidewalk. It's called The White Piano. How it floated in the townhouse, whose glass facade was not a window, but a lens through which I peered. How it glowed against the dark of the other rooms, against the gloom of that hour, slick as a luxury ship that appears on the sea of winter, the bleak cold of a city street. How solid and yet ethereal, as if suspended on clear thread, the dangled promise of another life. I stood before it, waiting. But how still its bone-white fingers remained, how relentlessly empty that room. Anyone who remembers the 1950s and 60s handbags that our mothers used can relate to this sonnet, but despite its title, it's really about my mother. Handbag. Strap grafted onto her forearm, it swung like a clock's pendulum as my mother walked, or more precisely, strode farther and faster than anyone else. She belonged to herself alone and marked time to that swing and jangle within, bag locked with the sound of a vault closing to block marauders. Heat job, blanket, bank, anodyne, purse to heart clutch or cradle, slab of black leather impenetrable, secret mother lode unreachable, protector of the code unbreakable. Yet when I fell and cracked my skull, she ran to me. It flew from her grip and lay abandoned by a wall, mouth agape. And this is my newest poem, set on the subway, as many of my poems have been. It's called Speaking in Tongues. He sits across from me on the train, and because custom demands that no eyes meet, I gaze at his feet, then the tongue of his left thrust shoe. A worker's heavy, sturdy shoe with its thick, stiff tongue rising high from frayed and splattered laces, the tongue that must make way each morning for the calloused foot and pushed back unpaid overtime hours later to release the swollen foot. The tongue that lies close to cement steel beams the earth above the worn-down soul that lives even closer. When the doors open at the factory stop, another man enters, and he too wears battered, dusty boots. But his are restless, tapping and grinding into the floor as if the machine still lived within. And real fast, 37 seconds and counting, a real short one called When You Leave a Room. Scatter your sequins into the chasm of sofas to be found by future generations. Mingle feathers from your headdress with those of the caged green bird. Make static. Crisscross your legs at least three times and change the subject often. Then exit. Tap down dancing backwards in code. Thank you.
From the archives of Italian Americana. It was one of the first poems I ever had published back in 2007, and it's called Nana's Earrings. My Nana wears clip-on earrings. They are costume pearls, real to her and to me. They lie low on lobes almost as big, flapping a handspan away as she chatters at the end of the day in the after-dinner tints of the milk glass lamp. At her rosewood vanity, she slips them off with a clip from each. A green streak left where their lobes have been. The gobs are handed off to me to quieting hands and quieting pleas if I say that I have been good. They nip a bit when they sink into skin of still a fragile whip. I strut the room like Rita Hayworth, hoping they will pierce. My Nana claps her hands at me and I run to them for her to take the heavy balls and lay them in their special sleeping place, a box that came from somewhere far. with empty pockets meant for things my Nana doesn't know to want. And this is from Inkwell, from Manhattanville College. It's entitled Left. They give her a room with a bottle green glow, a 40-watt bulb in its vintage shade, and a place where divided dinners sit on plastic trays before they are brought up, tepid, safe, and left, as dust in not quite empty rooms gives in, winkling in what remains of quiet light, a light dismissed by those outside as a switch overlooked in otherwise endless dark. And my last one is pending publication in Daniela's Me Too Ankyo anthology. It's called Boys of Summer. Not all can hear the call to arms sprung from seasons within, when fathers kiss their girls goodbye and escort their princes to battle. Canvas sacks of armor are slid from their steeds, slung over breastplates the colors of the kingdom, which is all. Sacks are cast on neutral soil, hands clasped with vine monarchs whose burrows they would see shamed. They come to this field as a right. They come to pit princes against other sovereigns, whom they grow tall and to be rivals. It is the sire's privilege to confer his sword, to grant weapons with which to topple mounting kingdoms, reserving spoils. Princes take up positions once held by their kings, a customary spectacle bestowed and received. In dreams, the fragile shapes of boys fly on spurs mothers will clean, until their undersides are as unsoiled as the day they were freshly knighted, yet never distressing the father's mark, while daughters miss what is not theirs, and boys ride home with their father's favor. Thank you.
Time to some people. Two of you were fortunate enough to have the clock stopped. And it's a pleasure for me to introduce Daniela Giuseppi. She is the author of numerous books of poetry, a book or two of prose, and also the editor of a few anthologies. Her books in each of those categories have been recognized with awards, and while her poetry speaks for itself, I also want to say that she has had one anthology, two, one on gender and one on race, that have been recognized and that I actually saw and heard hailed, lauded in Italy a long time ago. Daniela has also been very much associated with Bottega Press from the beginning, actually before the press even existed, because this is a story Fred and I and Paul always like to tell. When we first started to put together the aforementioned anthology Voices from the Margin, Writings in the Italian Americana, we were going around writing to people, and we were getting some bites and not some bites, and we wrote to Daniela, and after we wrote to Daniela, all of a sudden all these people started writing to us and sending us poetry. She just seemed to be clicked or locked into a circuit, and people felt comfortable enough, I guess, to send us their work. We weren't really known as editors, whatever. I was a professor of Italian. Italian American Studies was new to me, and in that field, no one really knew who I was. So that just speaks volumes to all sorts of things with regard to, number first and foremost, her confidence in us. So, but I also want to mention someone else, and I think that Daniela would agree that he represents in some ways the later, exactly current generation, and he's also a good friend of Bottega Press, and that's Peter Covino, who is our current poetry editor and wasn't supposed to be with us tonight, but he is here, and so I took over a little bit that task, but we're looking forward to giving it back to you for next year, and also looking forward to you reading, because you haven't read in these first 3 years, and I think that we need to get you up here. So pardon me, Daniela, for taking a minute for Peter, and the microphone is yours.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, I'm the exact same age as Nancy Pelosi, and aren't I proud of her? You know, if we could get rid of those other two, she would be president, and she'd make a great one. So I had my life saved by another Italian-American woman last year. Her name is Dr. Claire Boccia, who's head of female cardiology at Morristown. And I just happened to meet her, and she's one of the great cardiologists for women's heart disease in the entire country, and I was just lucky to bump into her because she saved my life last year. So I'm so glad to be among you, so many of you whom I've known for years. And actually, when I published my first book with Bordighera, I had published other poetry and other books, but when I published the first time with Bordighera, it wasn't because I couldn't publish elsewhere, it's because I wanted to be part of this community and help this community come forward. So I founded the first Bordighera Poetry Prize, and we published 16 poets, and I've been at this microphone introducing other poets for many years, and that's how I first met Peter Covino, because he was a runner-up 1 year, and I thought he should have been the winner. That was my, but I didn't have the final say on any of those. I only helped do all the volunteer labors that I put into 16 years of volunteer labor into the Bordighera Prize. But I see others here like Stephen Massimila, Maria Tyrone, so many people that I met through doing that. And so I'm very pleased to be part of Bordighera Press and to see how it's grown and to know so many of you and to be among you. I'm so pleased to be here. My first trip back to New York in over a year and a half, I moved out. I lived here for 50 years and moved out about a year and a half ago to Summit, New Jersey. So I'll begin by reading the first poem I think I ever published in Via many years ago in 1981 when my Italian immigrant father died. So this is for Donato Giuseppe, born 1906 in Italia in He's Pugliese, like Anthony, and like Joseph Tusciani and some of us who came from that part of Italy. And he died in 1981 when I was writing at the Edna St. Vincent Millay studio in Steepletop, New York. I had a little grant to go there and do some writing, and it was just after he died. So, American Sonnets for my father. You died in spring, father. And now the autumn dies, bright with ripe youth, dulled by time. Plums of feeling leaked red juices from your eyes, blood hemorrhaged in pools to still your quivering mind. At 40, I climbed Point Pinnacle today, thinking of you gone forever from me. In this russet November woods of Malay. I wear your old hat, dear Italian patriarch, to see if I can think you out of your American grave to sing your unwritten song with me. I carry your silenced poetry with your spirit. I take off your old black hat and sniff at it to smell the still-living vapor of your sweat. You work too hard, an oldest child of too many, a thin boy in ragged knickers. You limped through the 1920s, up city steps, door to door, with your loads of night and daily newspapers, each worth a cheap labored penny of your family's keep. You wore your heart and soul sore, at 40, not climbing autumn hills like me. You lay with lung disease, strapped down with morphine, hearing your breath rattle like keys at the gates of hell. Your body was always a fiend, perplexing your masculine will. You filled me with pride and immigrant tenacity, slave to filial duty, weaver of our dreams. You couldn't be free to sing. So be it, you are done, unfulfilled by song, except in me. If your dreams are mine, live again, breathe in me, and be. You never understood America's scheme. Your wounded dream, Father, will never heal in me. Your spirit mourns forever from my breath, aches with childhood memory, sighs for my own mortality in you, which I at last accept more completely than ever when we laughed together and seemed we'd go on forever, even though we always knew you would die much sooner than I, who am your spirit come from you. Remember, a father lost his, you told us, preparing us with Shakespearean quotation and operatic feeling for your inevitable death. Good night. Go gently, tired immigrant father, full of pride and propriety. We, your three daughters, all grew to be healthier, stronger, more American than you. Sensitive father, I offer you this toast. I've never known a braver man, no empty boast. The wound that will not heal in me is the ache of dead sensibility. Once full of history, philosophy, poetry, physics, astronomy, your bright, high-flying psyche is now dispersed, set free from your tormented body. Sheer, luminescent soul, glisten with enough light to carry us all full-grown. So that's a tribute to the immigrants from which some of us came, and I don't know, there aren't so many of us first generation who came from immigrants, maybe around so much, but that was a Bordighera book, and I was so pleased because it was translated by five wonderful Italian poets, Ned Condini, who has now passed from us, Blood Autumn, Autunno di Sangue. I finally had a bilingual book in both English and Italian, which I was thrilled to have and be translated by several Italians. I'll read just two other poems. This one is from a new book, not from Bordighera, called Waging Beauty as the Polar Bear Dreams of Ice. I've been working a great deal as an activist in climate crisis, and this book was spurred by that fact. Big-hearted, witty, and wide-eyed. Earth, she's been around for about 4.5 billion years, and the first third of her billions were mayhem. Meteorites crashed into her, magma everywhere, acid rain falling on her, until finally her first wildlife, fungi, mushrooms, starting forming. Then only single-celled ocean critters for another third of those billions of years. Sex life didn't show up until the last third of those billions of years. In the Cambrian age, plant animals with weird fronds and sea tubes copulating like seahorses. Trilobites paddled around for a few billion years more until ancient forests grew and dinosaurs crunched among trees, chewing her photosynthesizing leaves. We humans have been here for a very short time. Before us came mushrooms, fish, orangutans, chimps, and Neanderthals, and with us humans came arrowheads, Cleopatra, fireworks, guns, and the naming of stars. And you and I, with our MP3s and books, our masquerade costumes and fancy shoes and recipes, regrets, dreams, hopes, mouths we've kissed and wished we'd kissed, have existed for a microscopic bit of time, a slice of time so comparatively thin you'd need a microscope to see it. Just take a file off that bit of time and you'd wipe out Shakespeare, ancient Greece, Dante, and the Bible, to say nothing of all those hundreds of Hollywood flicks. We're each a mote dancing in a beam of light for a second that's passing amid crowds of over 7 billion alive today and billions dying yesterday. So I say, be big-hearted, witty, and wide-eyed with wonder. read about the Anthropocene age, love some others, paint, sing, taste everything lawfully possible, and help save the kids from climate crisis, because you still have a few hours left. Thank you. And pardon me for being strong on the last, but so many of us don't realize how little time there is to save all civilization, let alone Italian-American civilization. There's like about 10 years left if we don't move fast, so call your representatives every day. This is not a political issue. This is an issue of survival of everything now. And it doesn't mean it'll die all at once. It'll die slowly from lack of water, food, climate refugees. 5 million a year will be tapping on your windows for bread. As the shorelines drown, there's no stopping the shorelines from drowning anymore. We will reach tipping points and no return. So it's all hands on deck, all hands on deck. I give up a lot of my writing and love of literature to work on this. I give talks about it. I'll be talking for the Sierra Club on the 10th of April about the Green New Deal. So call your representatives and ask them to support the Green New Deal. It's bipartisan. I'll end with this short poem, if I may. I'm so pleased to be here. I hope I'm not making you unhappy, but you know, we have to talk about the reality. We're trying to avoid it. I'd rather avoid it. I'd rather just love poetry and have a good time. Really, I much rather would, but I hope Earth will remember me. That ashes of my spirit, my words, my love will live in new life fertilized by me. I hope I'll nurture the roots of a tree, feeling singing birds on its branches. I'd love to be heard in the song of a river as it flows through green, mossy forests. I'm glad all the water I drank will be recycled for flowers to drink in new gardens I'll never see, except in my dream of coming spring. Snow falls in my sleep now, as I long for cricket sounds, night's comforting music. I hope my aging calcified bones will nurture strength in children to be. I long for an earth of tomorrows where new beings might recall the good things we're made of, born of, exploding stars. In this mysterious life of sorrow, beauty, longing, and love. We made it stardust. Thank you. It really is lovely to be with you.
Our second featured poet I'm delighted to introduce is Judith Vollmer, who is also the featured poet in the current issue of Italian Americana. Judith came from Pittsburgh to be with us tonight, so I really appreciate it. Judith Vollmer is the author of 5 books of poetry, including the Apollonia poems, University of Wisconsin Press, Four Lakes Prize from 2017. She has received fellowships from the National Endowment for the Arts and the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts. Her poetry and criticism have appeared in Poetry International, the Georgia Review, Poet Lore, the Cambridge Companion to Baudelaire, the Women's Review of Books, and elsewhere. Vollmer lives in Pittsburgh. Thank you.
Pleasure to be here this evening in this chilly, rainy night, but in this lovely, warm space. And thank you to Maria for inviting me and supporting these new poems that are in the journal. And it's a pleasure to meet Anthony Tembury. And to hear all these lovely poems tonight. So I clap again for all the other poets we read, really. Pittsburgh, my city. I write a lot of poems to Pittsburgh, love poems to Pittsburgh in a way. And about a year ago, we suffered a landslide and then fire, in part caused by history of the dramatic geography there. We're not only a city of three rivers that converge in the center of the city, but all these amazing cliffs and hillsides. And that event caused the first poem I'll read. The Immolation. I didn't know what I was looking at, driving through the storm, afraid as I've always been of thunder and lightning. When I saw the steaming thing, spitting siding and roof, burst, flayed, hissing and throwing fire down onto the porch that hung like a jaw. The cliff was pulling at it, as it too was falling deeper into another mudslide, third this spring, the spring after three winters, iced over March, April, and front of May. And someone's own house was dying up there. Someone's one and only. Pity this benediction on windows and the trees lit up like x-rays that might show us the way, their fine intelligence bending down to the river. And this one is in praise of the hawthorn tree, and thanks again to Maria for her good editorial eye on this poem. We had a long discussion in email about the haws, you know, the value of the berries in the tree and the beautiful blossoms that have a terrible stench. But if you place them outside your door, they bring blessing to your house. But you must not take them into the house. It's called Open Grove. I've waited all summer to come back, cut into the woods behind a line of sumac, thriving at the berm I walk afternoons unbothered. If I've studied my girlhood hard and escaped harm or don't remember, if I've wept over my sister's story and learned from it, maybe I know either patience or a tree's timing. Just after first frost, the hawthorn's berries are ripe. Open grove, holy bramble witch, and fence. Keep small girls from falling out. Keep men from breaking in. No matter how many times I call on green, I can't touch it. But I'll steep the fleshy haws and brew the tonic that fires its heart. And I'll read two poems from my most recent book, The Apollonia Poems. My brothers and I had sold the childhood home, and my mother became very ill, and my friend, the poet Jan Beatty, gave me some advice. She said, this will be a very sad day when you lock the door of that house for the last time. So before you do that, try placing four notes inside the house. Hide them so the new owners who come will be blessed in that way. So I did that, and then all the voices of the dead started arriving in some of the new poems. So this poem is called Mother Comes, and the daughter voice is the one who's asking all the questions. Mother Comes. And I should say a footnote on the poem. Before there was the book The Joy of Sex, there was a famous book in the 50s. It had a blue cover, it was large, and my mother kept it hidden in her linen cupboard in the dining room. And she made a mistake of putting Almond Joys and candies in there, too. So I found the book, and, you know, it's 7 years old. I was terrified by its illustrations and hairiness and et cetera. Mother Comes. Was I a boy or a girl? Both and neither. It took me a while to figure that out. 30, 40 years? Long enough to know I didn't know. You burn the candle at both ends. But I've had great love affairs and suffered the consequences. Who knows, daughter?
was it with the big blue book? Oh, everybody had that in the 50s. Your father and I got one. Even the priest knew. Lots of pillows, positioning of the woman for the convenience of the man. Haven't you learned anything by now? You only taught me your idols. Thoreau, a virgin. Leopardi, a virgin. Dickinson, maybe. Probably not. Maybe. No. No wonder I was confused. Babies are babies. The two I lost, I still think of. How did you grieve? We drove to Lake Erie and threw our sorrows in. We drove to Niagara and threw more in. We drove to Chicago to the shrine of St. Jude. You were conceived. And I'll take a risk. I'm going to read a recipe poem in front of Stephen. This is that recipe for the zucchini flour that you stuff. And the many times I've tried it, it turns out like a flat, soggy pancake. But here is the poem in hopes of. It's called Flour Meal. I slid the sliver of anchovy that holds the sea inside the cube of roviola, and that I slid inside the flour. When I pinched the blossom shut, I kissed it, dipped it in egg, flour, and the golden oil, then carried it on the white plate, and when you lifted it to your mouth, did you remember? Every flower is a savant. Only last night your mother was waiting for you here on Via Marulana. And remember, you'd just read that strange novel with that title, and then a word from a stranger brought you to my table, where the jasmine loves to fall onto the dark zucchini. So when I, with my hands, open and fill this orange flower, have I not opened you too? A hungry mouth, which is voice, and your salt, sweet, restless soul. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Okay.
Wonderful. I want to thank you. I want to thank, first of all, Maria, for helping in a great deal putting this together. Nick, who is not here tonight, Nick Grosso, he went north this weekend, also was very much at the root of getting this all organized. So we just sent Nick stuff and then we put it together. I want to remind you that, first I want to thank everybody for coming. I want to thank you all for coming. It's raining out, you came when you knew it was going to rain, and that we appreciate that sacrifice. You know, poetry is perhaps one of the more exciting genres to read on the one hand, yet it also suffers from popularity. And perhaps because while it is exciting, it's also difficult. It also, in the sense that it requires of the reader a lot more work than prose usually does. That's not to downplay prose, but, and I say that because part of what I do is also textual criticism. And when you engage in interpretation theory and you read all the theorists, whatever, there are very few books that deal with theoretical issues that use poetry as the text. Mm-hmm. There are probably three or four that I come to mind right now. Usually it's always prose, and so for those of us in Italian studies who have, there are a few of us who have studied interpretation theory, but also have engaged in studying poetry, it's always been fun to bring the both of those together. But we've been loners to some extent, in a way. Anyway, it's changing, and that's good. As we said, both Fred and I underscored at the beginning, Bordighera Press was born out of the need for a venue for good work that couldn't find outlets because people who were and continue to run trade publishers have a different, let's say, aesthetic. So we're here to stay as long as we're here, and as we said before, we need those who are under 50 to come forward and pick up the slack after we decide to kick our feet up with a glass of wine. Speaking of good writers, excellent writers, more a prose writer, I want to remind you of a special event we're having here on May 2nd. It's here at 6 p.m., and it is to celebrate the legacy of Luis DeSalvo, who is a good friend of many of us here, who's also one of our colleagues here at the City University of New York and at Hunter College. And so that's the second. There are flyers in the background, and you can find them. And so with that, I want to wish you all a good Friday evening. There are some focaccine in the back, both vegetarian and non-vegetarian. And there's also some wine and water. There's no relationship there. No wine and not come from the water. And so with that, I wish you all a good evening. As you say in Italian, buon proseguimento.